want to talk about that a little bit more. But it's one of the big things that people like to hear from you about tonight, because it's such an essential part of trying to fix the police department, is having the community actively involved in working with their police department, overseeing their police department, and making sure the police department acts as the community wishes for it to act. This is our policing. One of the things that we saw is, and we've seen this in many cities across the country, is that proactive policing does not need to mean zero tolerance. It does not need to result in these types of things, these types of constitutional and federal law violations. You can be a good, proactive police officer in the city of Baltimore, anywhere in this nation, and you do it in a way that engages the community, which is respectful of the community, partners in the community to work together to solve the problems of crime and public safety in your community. And that's the vision that we have for EB. That's where we want them to go, is to be an effective partner with our community. Let me expand briefly, very briefly though, with some of the other comments that we made. I talked a little bit about stops. Congressman Cummings referred to this before. Our estimation found over 300,000 stops from 2010 until 2015, 300,000. As Congressman said, we also found that that number is likely very significantly underreported. That is not truly representative of the number of stops that were performed in the city. What we also found was that only 3.7%, a very, very small number, of 300,000, resulted in kind of citation or arrest. 3.7%. That makes us very concerned, as we outlined in our findings, that those stops were not made on the basis of reasonable suspicions as required by the Constitution, but instead were being done on other grounds. Illegal grounds, unconstitutional grounds, and we do not want that to persist. We found, and we noted this again in our findings report, one gentleman, over 50 years old, African American, we stopped him 30 times during the 5-year period. He's never cited, never arrested, and he stopped 30 times. I can't imagine what my relationship with my police department would be like if I was stopped 30 times. But I know that for many of you, that might be your experience every day. And that's not what we want to see happening, not what we want to see going forward. We also talked about race discrimination in the findings report. And this was really troubling to us because in almost every area that we looked, we found that African-Americans were disproportionately affected by PPD's policing activities. In stocks, searches, and arrests, consistently African-Americans were disproportionately affected. In searches, we found that African-Americans were far more likely to be searched, and they were also less likely to be found with anything wrong. They both were more likely to be searched and less likely to have contraband at any time, anything illegal in their career. The arrests, we found that the racial disparities were most pronounced for highly discretionary offenses. Offenses like failure to obey or disorderly conduct. African Americans were disproportionately arrested in those circumstances. And then we also found that despite some of the complaints that have been raised by community members like those of you in this room, we found a significant failure to adequately investigate complaints of racial discrimination by departments. And so that was a deeply troubling finding. We also found that PPD uses excessive force at a significant rate. This took on several different features. We found a failure to de-escalate. I think this is very closely related to the zero tolerance policing that we saw, because we saw officers repeatedly in the force review, force reports that we're looking at, take very aggressive approaches, overly aggressive approaches to an incident that resulted in force being used that in many circumstances was not necessary. We also found pattern of excessive force being used against people with disabilities, people with mental illness most particularly, or otherwise in crisis of some kind. We actually, in this report, for the first time, found that the police department, Baltimore Police Department, violated the Americans with Disabilities Act in the way that they interacted disabilities and where they use force. We also found excessive force against juveniles and against those who excessive force. In the 5-year period that we looked at, we found only one case where excessive force complaint was sustained against an officer. Number one. Where we are now, and where we're going, is these violations, which as I said before, resulted from systemic deficiencies. We need to now negotiate with the city of Baltimore. We're in the process of starting down that road with the city of Baltimore to fix our system. How are we going to fix it? What are the remedies? And the remedies are going to be outlined in the consent decree. We entered into what's called an agreement in principle with the city of Baltimore on the same day that we issued our first report. And in that agreement in principle, they agreed to do a few different things. Number one, they agreed that they were going to enter into a consent decree with us to remedy the issues that we saw and that we reported on in our findings. They agreed in there that that essentially is going to be subject to court oversight. And some of that is already alluded to earlier. But the federal court is going to make sure that we stand by our court and the city of Baltimore stands by its court and does what it says it's going to do in the consent decree. It's also going to be overseen by a federal monitor. That monitor is going to report to the court, not to the city of Baltimore under there. Because we work with the federal court to make sure that things are actually done. It also outlines in there that we're going to try and move very quickly to get to a consent decree. We are shooting to have a consent decree negotiated and filed by November 1st. That's extremely aggressive, and we are doing our very best to meet that deadline. The reason why we want to meet that deadline is because we do not want the concerns that we outlined in our findings report to persist one day longer than they need to, any longer than they need to. But we need to hear from each of you to make that consent decree be as good as we could possibly can be. So that gets on the last point that I want to say that we outline the agreement principles that we built into that agreement principle with the city's agreement. Public input period, right at the very beginning here, we are in the middle of that right now. It's due to end actually on Friday. That is not the end of the most obligation. That means that we want to hear from you as quickly as possible to be able to get your input on what needs to be remedied, what needs to be reformed in the Baltimore Police Department based on the findings that they made. So we will continue to engage with you. Your input is extremely important. We want to hear from you. And that's actually the purpose of tonight. So I'm very thankful to have this meeting tonight to be able to hear from each of you. Of course, the consent decree that we negotiate is going to hit on each of those areas from the findings that I already outlined. But it's going to be broader. It's going to include, as Ari said, accountability. We need to hear from you on what's going to make accountability really work with the Baltimore Police Department. Reforms have been attempted before. What's going to work this time? What's going to work making it actually? Internal investigations, what needs to be fixed? Recruitment and retention. What do we need to do to try to address the issues in Baltimore Police Department about that? Training, what needs to work better? What needs to be different about how training is done in the future? What kind of data needs to be collected? What kind of analysis needs to be done? What kind of data do you need in the community to know what your police department is doing and to be able to hold them accountable for how they police? And we also want to be trying to address in there certain types of programs or other types of services to prevent police department interactions in the first place. Mental health services, youth programs, what types of services can help prevent even having negative interactions with police department in the first place to try and cut that off? So that's another area that we're trying to address. Community policing, fundamental community policing is a key area of this consent decree. We want that to be proactive, we want it to be engaged, we want it to be collaborative, because we want the police and community to work together. And we need to try and start rebuilding that relationship through this consent decree. And then, maybe most critically, the community oversight. What should that look like? We want to share ideas on what that looks like. We've done different things in other cities. We've created community oversight in other places. But this needs to work for Baltimore, not just some cookie cutter that we brought from some other place. We don't want a cookie cutter. We want to know what you in Baltimore need to be able to partner with your police department. And so I just want to end with where
need the community to stay engaged. We need ongoing engagement from each of you. We need ongoing oversight from each of you.
The Baltimore Police Department is the Baltimore Police Department.
It needs to be the police department of the community. So we want to hear from you. We're very excited to be tonight, and we're thankful.